And it was very important to me that I found the right people. And so we said no to a lot of people. A lot of people doing inpatient treatment. Yeah, for the wrong reasons, for no reason at all, just for money, whatever. And then I met Jared and Evan. Evan's wife, Alexis. And I spent a week with them. And after that week, I decided these are the people that I want to be in business with. And all of us, Allison and Angie and Amy and I, we all went out to dinner with them. We got to know them. And also Drew. We all know Drew. Drew became a connector for us. And told us, you know. And we didn't know they knew Bob. We didn't know anything about that. Until I was down meeting Jared and Evan, and they go, "You want to go have smoothies with this guy, Bob?" And then then we went and had smoothies, and it was Bob Forrest. And now you have all seen the documentary. So we got Evan. He's the owner of Allo. Jared. Jesse, you want to introduce Alexis? Jesse, why don't you tell us a little bit about Alexis?
I can't even talk
her. And Dakota, that's
and Dakota.
Where's Harper?
Harper's at home.
And so, Bob, these guys have all seen your documentary. They're pretty stoked to hear you talk. And so, well, I think we all know, you know, he's going to tell us more, but we all know about you from your documentary, so.
Okay.
Welcome, Bob.
Well, thank you, guys. Is your real legal name Arthur?
Yes. Yeah.
Who is it still calling you Arthur?
They do.
I'm glad to be here. I just can't believe so many young people are trying to get sober. And, you know, I've been working in treatment for 20 years, and I was a patient for 10 years and saw that. And you know, drug addicts, they do what they do, and we come and we go, and we try to get it together and we can't. And, you know, but you learn something new, or at least I did, every time I tried to get sober, whether it was kicking at a friend's house and going to AA or going to a fancy rehab. It's like it's just all starting to add up. Right? And most of my friends these on the movie are all sober. We're all in our 50s. We're all sober. Only two people died that I ever knew died in all those years of using. And we used to shoot speedballs every day for decades. And only two people I knew died. Bill Stelbau, his name is, the guitar player in my band, and Ola Slovak, the guitar player in the Chili Peppers. In all that time, and everyone we knew did drugs. And not that, but we had survival instincts, and we were careful, and we were mentored by other drug addicts of how to stay alive, and what was extremely dangerous that you just didn't do, you know? And you know, when we'd go to the rehab, they'd tell us we're going to die. In 1988, I went to my first rehab, they told me I was going to die, because they always said that. Only, you know, I went back and looked statistically. 3,689 people died of opiate overdose death in 1988. And they were telling every drug addict that went to treatment that shot drugs, they were going to die. They were lying. They were exaggerating. Well, 30 years later, it's true. If you're sitting in this room and you're an opiate addict, the leading cause of death for you is opiate overdose death. And so over the last, like, 7, 8 years, it's just skyrocketed. And I became so obsessed with it, mostly because a patient died in my care. And I didn't know enough about OxyContin, right? OxyContin, see, traditionally, I just know when people are loaded. And you can smell pot, and you can smell heroin, and you can recognize coke and meth if somebody's relapsing in your sober living or in your treatment center. I can always recognize it. There's kind of legendary stories where my office was around behind the detox unit, and you had to walk around past the smoking area to go to see Dr. Drew. And I walked that walk like 100 times a day, right? And I could just walk past there, and the kids would be sitting there smoking, or the clients would be sitting there smoking, and I would get into the entryway of the office, of Drew's office, and I would stop, and I would just turn around and go back and go, something's going on here, right? something's going on. What's going on? Just by how your face looked, by how you avoided eye contact when I, there's just something really unnatural that if you're an alcoholic drug addict, you're attuned to other alcoholic drug addicts. There's an unknowable attunement. Well, that doesn't exist with prescription drugs. It doesn't. Oxycontin, benzos, you know, people are taking these copious amounts of drugs and they started dying in our treatment center. And we were just naive and didn't understand that addiction had morphed and mutated and we weren't up to speed about it. So since about 2007-2008, I've been obsessed with like, how do you fucking help these people, right? And you're these people. You probably all, my gateway drug was alcohol. I started stealing beer out of vacation houses near my house. I lived in Palm Springs. Me and my friends would just find an open window, go inside, we were 13 or 14, and get beer. We were scared of hard liquor. We'd just get beer, go out in the desert and drink it. We did that from when I was 14, 15, 16, you know, then. People who smoked pot, back in my day, it was called getting a buzz on. Remember? Getting a buzz on. And there was this kid, Ross Einbodden, that lived in my neighborhood, and he was like 2 years older than him and his friend, when I was about 14, he said, we were all sitting by these motorcycles, and he said, come on, dude, let's go get a buzz on. And to his friend. And I was like, 13, and I said, I want to get a buzz on, and they said, Bobby, you're too young to get a buzz on. There used to be ethics and honor among kids, right? That 13 is just too young to help you get stoned. Is that the environment you grew up in?
Nope.
No. They'll fucking shoot you up with heroin.
Yep.
You know what I mean? So things change. Sociologically, we change as a society, right? And everybody's trying to figure out how to help you millennials, how to help you young people that have been doing opiates since you're 13, that don't care whether you're homeless or don't have any dreams in life or don't like life. It's a very different generation of addiction. And so Art's one of the cutting edge people that I'm listening to and watching. Like, what the fuck do you do with them? Because I'm all about self-autonomy and get your shit together. And I realize that dealing with this whole generation of drug addicts, you don't even know what getting your shit together means. I knew what get my shit together meant since I was 8 years old. Right? You've got to start looking at the fundamentals of life as what do you want in life? Right? And then how do I achieve it? And I think that, you know, parenting is a bad component of it, a contributing component of it, but society itself is a contributor to your state of mind about life. Nobody gives a fuck about you. You've been told your whole life that you're so special and everybody gives a fuck. No, people are measured by their actions and achievements, not by their words or being born. You've been getting trophies, right? Just because you put a uniform on, right? You're the first generation. Like, when I was a kid and you played baseball, you had to lead the league in home runs or you had to fucking be good. And then you got a trophy. Right? You get a trophy just because, you know, the first time I'm a 30-year-old, so I know what I speak of. So, I coached the basketball team when I got sober. He was like, 13. He's a horrible basketball player. 96. He was 12. And he was horrible. And his best friend Bo was great, right? And Bo practiced basketball all the fucking time. He went to school with basketball under his arm. He shot shots all night long, out after dinner, out in their against their garage. My son didn't care about that. He's like more of an artist, musician, whatever that is. But he won. Because Bo's dad was a guitar player in my band, so we had these two guys who were going to coach their kids playing basketball, right? And this is in 1998. And so Elijah, my son, was really not very good. He couldn't even really dribble a ball, kids like that. And Bo was super good. So then I'm coaching, obviously Elijah's not going to play. you know, because of the way I come from, you put the five best players on the fucking court. And unfortunately, the coach's son is not going to play, right? The only time I would put him in is to foul the other team's best player five times. So then the parents, after about midway through the season, they're rebelling against me that all the kids should play. And I go, my own kid doesn't fucking play. You know what I mean? You want to teach how the world works, or do you want to act in some fantasy bullshit world? Because the best players play basketball. The best players practice being good. And that's then they're rewarded with playing time. And when they're really, really good, they're rewarded with trophies. So when the end of the season comes, I almost quit because the parents wanted me to quit, right? Because I wouldn't play all the players, and like, oh, we just like, I couldn't watch it, like, watch them dribble it off their foot, like, what the fuck are you doing? Right? So that's for practice. They get to dribble the ball and do things at practice, but this is a game. So I almost got kicked out of the Echo Park youth basketball league by the parents. And at the end of the season, you know, I'm kind of an absent-minded professor, so they said, you know, we have to have this thing at Chakey's Pizza and whatever. And so I get there, and KK's mostly taking care of it all. And I go there, and there's 12 trophies, all equal. It was the first time I had ever seen this. You kids grew up in this world. I was like, what the fuck is that? Is there another team coming? Right? And each kid got to go up there and pose with the coaches with their trophy, right? And of course, they're selling those pictures for $29.99, right? And my son, who's really, really very smart, very intelligent kid, he's sitting in the front seat, we're driving home, he's looking at the trophy and goes, Dad, you know what's fucked up? And I know it's bad, well, I'm a 12-year-old use that for him, but that's how we were. He goes, you know what's fucked up? I don't care about basketball at all. This doesn't mean anything to me. And it means everything to Bo. And he's got the same fucking trophy. My 12-year-old child knew better than adults about how the world works, how you teach young people, how the world works, right? So you're the ones that got the trophy, right? And you come up into the world, and what's surprising is I have this theory about millennials. Everybody's been telling you you're so great, and you're so special, and you're so wonderful, and everything's great, and you're just going to be a millionaire, and all this kind of bullshit. And then you turn 18, you're not going to high school anymore, and they're like, no.
Right? That would have been a good picture.
Hold on a second, is there a trophy here? So, and somewhere along the line, this saturation of opiates in America, and that's a whole other story, that comes from anesthesiologists who were losing their jobs.
Yeah.
And it's called pain management. That's how Oxycontin came to create the storm that we have now. But the naivete on the part of government and our parents and even myself personally, it's the only time Drew has been right and I've been wrong. Most times I'm right and he's wrong, just so you know. But Drew said, this is going to lead to the biggest heroin epidemic in history when the Oxycontin thing started happening. And I was like, yeah, these people are too much pussies to take heroin. They're not going there. And I was wrong. We were not to, you know, because heroin's been demonized for 70 years in this country. Only bad people, only evil people, only criminals, only outlaws do heroin. That's why I wanted to do it. You know what I mean? Like, count me in. But that's not the mass of the American public. They like to think of themselves as good Christians and good people and blah, 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 that I've never been. So I never thought this could happen in America. That everywhere across the United States, in Vermont, in Alabama, in Nebraska, there would be people shooting heroin in the streets. I kind of fantasized that would be a great world, and to my disease, you know what I mean? Because it was really hard to find heroin through the 80s and 90s, right? I think you saw the movie, so all my friends were heroin addicts, and we were all in bands, right? Our main problem is, and we were based in LA, the bands who were based in the Midwest, like The Replacements, Soul Asylum, Butthole Surfers, Meat Puppets, they had easier routes to go, because you could go from Minnesota down through Chicago and New York, and there's all coke there and drugs there, and then you could just go back. But if you leave LA, there's nothing. You're going all the way across the United States, and you're not coming back in 2 weeks home where you can get dope. So our main fear always was Mendy Dopesick. Because first couple of tours, you can't bring enough dope. Everybody knows that. Right? And usually the routes are, you either come up here, you play San Francisco, Portland, Seattle, Vancouver, then you're just fucked for like 2 weeks until you get to Chicago, right? So I always tell this story on Super Bowl Sunday, and then I got a reputation as somebody that the managers and booking agents and everybody wanted to keep out of Chicago, New York, you know what I mean? So our tour, we would play there, and then there's a thing called wheels in, wheels out in show business. So wheels in, wheels out means you're not staying in that town. You're driving there to play on a tour bus or a plane, wheels in, wheels out. You're going there to play, and then you have to go to another city to play. Well, we would never go to the next city we're playing. We'd go like 100 miles outside of town where the managers knew I couldn't find heroin. Right? So I was sitting in a town called Normal, Illinois. You can look it up. In the late 80s, early 90s, there's a town called Normal, Illinois, about 90 miles south of Chicago. We played Chicago, and you know, I was drunk all the time when we were done playing. They're like, wheels up, come on, we're going. And I was like, dude, we're in fucking Chicago, why are we leaving? You know what I mean? And so we're in Normal, Illinois. It was Super Bowl Sunday. It was the day off. I woke up in a Holiday Inn, and I was like, fuck are we? And I looked outside, it was just flat, and no buildings, and I was like, oh God, and then I realized it was Sunday, and that we weren't playing, and I had nothing to do, but I had some money, right? So I went to the front desk, and I said, can you call me a cab? Because I'm dope sick, and you know, hungover, all that mishigash of what you are, I just have to have drugs. And the guy goes, okay, and he calls right at the front desk, and just asked for, like, is Barry there? And like, I was like, the fuck is he calling? The cab company, because it's Normal, Illinois. You just call the guy's house. There's one cab. It's the guy's house. And the guy comes to pick me up, and I get in the car. And it's this old black dude, really cool black dude. And he goes, where are we going? And I say, I know this is going to sound really strange to you, but I have money, and you know how you flash the money? Like, I'm not ripping you off. I want to go to Chicago. I want to be there for literally, like, 7 minutes. And I want to come back here. And I'll pay you whatever. And he's like, puts it in drive, and starts to pull out of the Holiday Inn driveway, and then he gets to the street, and he pulls over, and he puts it in park again, and he turns to me, and he goes, can I ask you a question, young man? And I said, sure. And he goes, why are you going to Chicago like that? And I said, well, I'm going to be totally honest with you. I'm going up there to get drugs, but I'll hold them on me. I would never do anything wrong. I like honesty. Just going to get drugs and come back. What kind of drugs? Heroin? And I was like, yes, sir. I remember, he goes, you don't have to go to Chicago to get heroin. And he goes, you want me to go to the spot? And I was like, yes. And he told me, well, I'm going to Illinois. And that's when I told this story to other friends, and I got that cab driver's phone number to all that would listen, because it's a college town, everybody played there. And little by little, This rules came about of how to tour. That was one. Find somebody, anybody that finds a dope dealer in any town, spread the news to Jane's Addiction, Chili Peppers, and everybody else, right? So then I was somewhere and I was dope sick and I couldn't figure out what to do. And I remember this guy, Top Jimmy, who's in the movie. He always said, if you're really desperate, go to the methadone clinic. Every county has one in America. And so, you know, I remember that. So then I was dope sick and I went down to the methadone clinic. It was closed, right? This is like 4 p.m. It's not open, but they always keep the methadone clinic where the worst part of town where the drugs are, right? You see somebody walking around. So it just became this desperate need to get drugs. And the recurring, remitting, stopping, and starting, that it's called, was just built into the fiber of America. Drugs were illegal. You could go to prison for pot. You know what I mean? So drugs, there was all this kind of world that kind of protected us from ourselves. There's no longer that world protecting you from yourself. You're going to have to protect you from yourself. And that is become enlightened, you know, be smart. You know, nobody's expecting that everybody in this room is going to be sober the rest of their lives. Right? What I'm here to tell you is don't die. That is the number one priority in all of this. Don't die. Now, how do you die? Benzos and opiates. That's how you fucking die. Every one of your friends did that. Or the newest weird caveat is fentanyl heroin. Right? So start putting yourself, loving yourself and putting yourself, regardless of your trauma, regardless of your addiction, regardless of your surrender, regardless of whether you like AA or you like being sober, all that'll be sorted out. But at least have one top priority, is you're going to live through this hell. Right? And it is hell. I got to tell you, the one thing that doesn't make sense to me is, my life was great. You saw the movie. It was fucking fun. I have yet to see any of you young people, opiate addicts, that have had as much fun as me and my friends. You start out not having fun, and then you just keep doing it not having fun. Right? Am I right? It's fucking crazy. Like, you know, me and Leanne had so much fun for so many years, that's why we got habituated into it. But when you're going to rehab when you're 17 and everybody's mad at you and you're fucking ODing all the time, like, how is that going to get better? You know what I mean? How is that? You're going to wake up and someday you're going to squeeze some fun out of it? No, you're starting in some strange late stage addiction.
Yeah.
Very early in your life. You know what I mean? And so, you know, another reason why you're going to treatment is this lack of understanding of survival and fuck you. You don't have enough antisocial personality anymore. You know what I mean? So the examples being all through the using years, even before I went to rehab, people would give me ultimatums. I don't want to be in a band with you if you're going to be on heroin. Well, then fuck you. Find another band. That happened repeatedly. That's why there were so many people in my band. Right? And you know, I had a great girlfriend that I really cared about a lot, but she had entered into a relationship with someone. She knew who I was. She knew how I lived. She liked it. She participated in living like that. But after a while, she decided, I need to change him so we can live the way I want to live. And that's, I just said, fuck you. She said, you either have to go to rehab or I'm going to leave you. I said, let's get a U-Haul truck. Nobody is going to tell me what to do. Get a little bit of that. Read a book and try to find some of that. It's in Jack Kerouac, On the Road. It's in Junkie by William Burroughs. It's in literature. It's in Jane Eyre. There's a great part in Jane Eyre where she's in an orphanage and a friend dies because the headmaster's such an evil fuck. And he's trying to make her break and bow down and capitulate to his hideous system of fascism. And she says, your friend Nancy died because she was a bad girl and she didn't listen. And do you want to die, Jane? And she said, no, I will stay in good health and not die. She didn't bow down to him and say, oh, I'm sorry. She just said, I will stay in good health and not die. That is what I want you to say. Don't die. You don't have to give in to what I think or what Art thinks or anybody thinks. You can make your own mishigosh version of it. My thing is not how I was taught it, right? I took the information that was being given to me in the 80s and 90s and I took what really made sense to me. And I disregarded what doesn't, right? And finally, I assembled a system that makes sense to me to put drugs and alcohol behind me and find joy some other way, right? It's about joy. It's about finding wholeness, right? And drugs made me feel whole for a long time, right? This is the only wholeness I knew, right? you would think like making music and playing and making money and doing whatever you want would make you feel whole. Not if you're a trauma victim. Not if you've been fucking raped when you were a kid like me. No. No amount of money or fame or white picket fence or this girl or that boy is gonna fix it. I have this theory, I mean, we're in a friend of mine's hometown, or Aberdeen, it's not far from here. So there are very few people in the world that have had what Kurt Cobain had. Right? And you guys maybe just heard about it through, you know, Behind the Music MTV story or something, but you know it in your culture, right? So Kurt was one of the only people of my generation that was looked up to by his peers, like me, Anthony. Like, the first time I ever heard Teen Spirit, Anthony Kiedis said, I gotta play you something. And we used to always play songs for each other. Like, when he was making a record, he'd play me songs. I'm one of the first people that ever heard Under the Bridge, and I was like, motherfucker. Like, that is way better than anything I've ever done. So he called me, and he goes, you home? And I was like, yeah, he's called me. You know, this is before cell phones. And he goes, you got to hear something. I thought it was one of his songs. So then it was like, you know, it took 10 minutes to get to my house. And he comes in and he just knocks on the door and goes, come on, you got to hear this song in his car. And because sometimes cassettes, what you used to record songs on, sounded better in your car. So he goes, where should we go? We have to go to a special place for you to hear this song. And I go, Jesus, you're being dramatic. You've got to go to a special spot. And so we went above downtown LA in what's called Chinatown on this hill overlooking downtown LA. And it was evening time. And he looked at me and he goes, are you ready to hear this? And I go, yeah. And he pushed it in, you know, the old cassettes go click. And he turned it way up. And Teen Spirit played. And I was like, by the time it got to the chorus, I was like, that's that kid from Seattle. And he said, and it ended, and he goes, what do you think of that? And I was like, play it again. It was a song that represented how we all felt. Right? Fuck you is the theme of that fucking song. I'm not a bad person. I'm just fucking angry, and all this is bullshit. It's in 3 minutes and 38 seconds. It's perfection of describing a generation, right? So very few people were respected like Kurt was, like as a songwriter, as a person, as a like front person, as a ethically, right? And nobody had his financial and success. It was like the Beatles' second coming. So he had both. Like, I had respect. Everybody said, Bob's the greatest songwriter ever. Everybody did. But I didn't sell records like Chili Peppers and Nirvana, right? So there was all that, good, but fuck it. Trade it all in to write some fucking shitty. My friend John wrote something called Cherry Pie. I was like, fuck, I wish I wrote that song. How many millions of dollars did that fucking song generate? She's my chili pie. So there's these two worlds. There's respect, and then there's financial rewards. And no one ever had what that boy had. And what did he do? Did he die accidentally of a drug overdose? No. He didn't die like John Lennon murdered. He didn't die like Bob Marley of cancer. He didn't die of a drug overdose like Jimi Hendrix. He killed himself. Because he was traumatized, and he had gotten to the place where no person I've ever known had gotten to, which is, this should make you whole. And it doesn't. So if it doesn't for him, it's not gonna for you, and it's not gonna for me. You've got to do that sorting out within yourself. A white picket fence is not gonna do it. Having a baby is not gonna do it. It's not gonna do it. Nothing's gonna fix it. Fame is not gonna fix it. Money is not gonna fix it. You are gonna have to be courageous and face it. And sometimes it's even boring, like talking about it over and over again. But somehow I gained insight about what happened to me, right? And became, I wouldn't say I'm healed, I understand it now. I live with it. I understand it. Right? They asked the Dalai Lama one time, what is wrong with the world? Like, that's a good question for somebody. He's at the Wilton Theater. He's like a rock star, really. And they asked him, somebody from the audience, they get to stand up and ask a question. And they said, what is wrong with the world, Master? And he said, good question. Lack of insight. He didn't say the Chinese government. He didn't say capitalism. He didn't say your mom. Right?
That's what you believe.
Lack of insight. It explains everything. When people do horrible, hideous things, it's lack of insight. When you're killing yourself with drugs, it's lack of insight. That philosophy explains all unhealthy irregularity in the world. Lack of insight. So what you're trying to do is gain insight. The steps can do that. Maybe they can't for you. They didn't really do it for me. Therapy did it for me. And being sober and watching myself go through the same relationship pattern. You have to be sober to even catch it, right? So I started recognizing, like, I keep having these same relationships over and over again, but the people are different. You know what I mean? Like, how many fucking times can you do this? Like, you know, and in my relationship history, we tend to have certain traits that we like in the opposite sex, but mine had no rhyme or reason to it. I went out with junky high school dropouts and college professors, and I would create the same relationship. Right? Where I'm emotionally unavailable and I get bored and I don't pay attention, but I don't cheat. I'm not a cheater. I just get bored and don't even acknowledge that you exist. Then you cheat. Then you cheat. And then I go, oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Right? So you start to watch that, you know, every 5 years. You know what I mean? And I know a lot of you are young and you're not going to really experience this till you're like in your 30s and 40s, but you can start to see how your trauma creates what you're attracted to, what your tendency is, right? So, and this is all based around your self-love. If you love yourself, you kind of are able to love and attach and detach with other people. But if you, when you don't love yourself, based on whatever the reasons are, abuse, neglect, you know, depression, dysthymia, whatever your cup of tea is, right? When you start to see how it actuates in your life, that's when you really gain insight about it. I'm not saying you cure it or stop it, but you can gain insight about it and you can start to see it say, and it doesn't profoundly throw you this way and that way. Because you've already been there before and you already know what's going on. To the point of, I had this situation in a relationship where that cycle had run its course, right? She had cheated on me and left me for another guy, and then 3 years later we got back together, just like in a movie, like with Tom Hanks and Ryan, right? And then she did it again. And I was like, I didn't even get upset. I was just like, holy fuck! This is amazing! You know what I mean?